Great. So now we move on to the next talk, and this is about IoT solutions and building your intelligent edge, creating using Azure IoT Edge. So IoT solutions are getting increasingly tapping on machine learning and AI in the cloud to learn and to build a better product. But what if we could keep using that intelligence that has already been trained closer to the device so that the device could get more and more improved over time, closer to the customer? Please welcome to the stage Mr. Gerhard Ebinger, Cloud Solution Architect for Partners from Microsoft, to the stage. And please give a big, big round of applause. Thank you.
Hello, can you hear me? Yes. Yes, hello, my name is Gerhard Ebinger. I'm from Microsoft. I'm Cloud Solution Architect for Partners. I'm helping partners in the practice data and AI to having in engagement with our new products. Most of my time I'm doing IoT project or IoT projects related to West Europe. So I do it in most of the time I'm in Swiss, also in Austria. And on the end, I'm a disaster recovery speaker because some days ago I even was not aware about that I have to speak today. It's because I jump in for a colleague. Before I start my presentation, I want to spend some sentence about this man and his new Microsoft. Without him, I wouldn't have ever thought about to join this company. Under the leadership of Steve Ballmer, they would never be able to make a presentation on a Mac. Yes, and it's unimaginable. Satya makes with this company 2014 a man overboard rescue turn because he had understand that customers already overboarded. And we're not speaking about a sailing boat, we're speaking about a very large cruise liner here. It's fantastic, the change about Microsoft, and I won't show up about these changes. Satya announced Microsoft loves Linux. We was part of the .NET Foundation was created. Visual Studio Code was released. I'm not sure if you'll be aware, but Visual Studio Code have nothing to do with Visual Studio. It's an open source product running on all platforms, Linux, Windows, Mac. We announced HD Insight, which is based on Hadoop and Ubuntu. And Microsoft was a leader in the foundation of the Node.js Foundation 2015. I will not go in detail in all because otherwise I run out of time. Keys, .NET Core.1, open source, all platforms. SQL on Linux, yes, not open source, but our biggest customer is Amazon, so we will not give him a big present. Microsoft joined 2016 the Linux Foundation. 2017, Kubernetes was launched. We support Postgres and MySQL in Asia as managed platform. We announced Databricks in Asia, what is the follow-up project of Apache Spark. Visual Studio 2018, Visual Studio Code was ranked in Stack Overflow as largest development tool, so largest used number one development tool. In IoT, we bring out the chip fully managed with Linux as an operation system. 5,000 Microsoft employees working open source in GitHub. And if I get in contact with support in my IoT projects, my first touch point is GitHub. Yes, and we now crossed this borderline some years ago, 30% Linux machine, 70% Windows machine on Asia. AWS completely contrary. Now we cross the border, 50% of all virtual machines in Asia are Linux. And this is the contributions of Microsoft employees in GitHub. We start 2014 with 95,000 contributions. 2017, we was at 780. And maybe we crossed the 1 million this year. What's the agenda for today? Why IoT Edge? How many of you did already an IoT project on Azure PaaS services? Can you raise the hand? So yes, not many. So I will give a little overview, what is Asia or IoT, and then I will go into Asia IoT Edge. So why IoT Edge? Let's start with this. Traditional IoT solutions produce a lot of data, and sending all this data into the cloud could sometimes be a problem. But on the end, you want to use the data, you analyze the data, you want to use it with high-value services like artificial intelligence, machine learning, or the cognitive services. However, in a real-world solution, you have some problems on that. So moving all the data could be a challenge, especially if the devices are very in the field. So we let's take this example. These are road pumps. And these road pumps that Schneider Electric puts in the field on very remote locations, and they produce a lot of data. If you stand on these road pumps, they produce, you're collecting pressure, humidity, you're connecting conditions of oil down in the airs, and if you connect a computer to the pump, you can also watch to this data. And Schneider comes to us and says, so then Schneider have technicians who go to the pumps and can analyze the data, but there are tons of pumps in the field, so it is nearly impossible to monitor and watch all of them. And Schneider comes to us and says, hey, can we create together a machine learning model that autonomously understand if there is a pump a problem, if service is needed, or we have to shut it, or we have to shut it down immediately. We make together this project, and then we collect all the data, we load it to the cloud, design the machine learning model, and after this we found out, unfortunately, most of the data in the model is needed to reach the target. So some AI or a machine learning model, you found out you need only 20% of the data, but in this case, most of the data was needed, so we have additional problem, because as I already tell you, these pumps are on the field, and sometimes they have immediate connections, or they connect via cells or satellites, or even very expensive. So now there was the question, are we able to bring the model down to the machines? And on the end, this is IoT Edge. Now, I'll give a short overview about IoT. The first service that we have in Asia IoT is IoT Hub. It's a kind of heart and soul of Asia IoT. Asia IoT Hub is the cloud service that ingests data into the cloud. And at some point, the devices send data and gives a few promises. So first of all, you can see that your data will send securely. This will send bidirectional. Bidirectional means you send data to the cloud, but you can also receive commands or something like this. And you can be sure that each device is identified unique. So you can understand what are the different devices and which device have the problem. Once the data is in the IoT Hub, then you have to pull it from the IoT Hub to further processes. So it's maybe to send it to a storage, or you need some of the data, because you need some of the data a certain amount of time. By the way, IoT Hub is not a storage. Even you can keep the data in the IoT Hub for 7 days, but it's not from the concept of a storage. So you must, on the end, you must take the data out, and then you can also process this with stream analytics, machine learning, or you visualize directly to Power BI or whatever tool you like to use. Yes. IoT Hub speaks 3 public protocol endpoints, so supports 3 public protocol endpoints. We are supporting message queuing telemetry transport protocol, advanced messaging queuing protocol, and HTTPS protocol. The last one is more or less if you have, there's no other way, and this is not bidirectional, you can only push it to the cloud with HTTPS. MQTT is much simpler and more focused as MQTP. And even you have a Q in the name and no P, it is a protocol without queuing. So there's queuing in the name, there is no queuing in. The reason to use AMQPP is reliability and interoperability. The initial design of this protocol was by J.P. Morgan from the mid-2014 to communicate between clients and message brokers in the banking industry. These endpoints are public documented. On the end, we keep the standards. If you love to write protocol code, you can do this by your own. However, most of the people probably hate to write protocol code, and this is the reason why we deliver also an device SDK. We give the client SDK that you can install. This is open source. You can download from GitHub. You can review the code. It is written in 5 different languages. The core is written in C, but on the end, we support C, C#, Java, Node.js, and Python. And it's implemented commands like connect to IRD Hub, send data to IRD Hub, and such these things. That means that this kind of code you don't have to write by your own. So just choose the protocol, what you like to use, and then we will take care about that everything is happened and secure, and you can concentrate on the business logic in the device. After this, the first question, if you understand how to write application, is how you bring your device to the right IoT hub, and how I tell the application where to connect. So for this, we introduce a service we named device provisioning service. The device provisioning service, on the end, allows devices with an X509 certificate to connect to the cloud. So you have one single endpoint in the whole over the world. You have to know this in front. You store this in the device, and during the device ramp-up, you get then later the information where the device have to connect. In the device provisioning service, so the device provides the certificate, then the device provisioning service looking in a table, because if you have, you can have same application on different device, and based on the device, you want to connect to different IoT hubs because you want to split this. And also, this is supported by the device provisioning services. So on the end, when the device leaves the factory and is the first time in the cloud, then you decide which IoT hub at which location. So on the end, we initialize the configuration, store the device credentials on the right IoT hub, send you to the device down the right credentials, and also the connections to the IoT hub, and so we established more or less in this way the connection between the device and the IoT hub. It is not necessary to use this. You can also develop this by your own, but it's an option. It's an optional service. So the next question, if you have a bunch of these devices in the field, is how to figure out where are my devices, which firmware is on, what kind of methods we send, and so on. And for this, we have a device management privilege. The first of is the device twin. Device twin is nothing more than a JSON document that each device gets and that represents the configuration of each device. So the device twin itself has 3 sections. It has tags, it has desired properties and reported properties. Tags are simply cloud metadata about your device, and even the device not really knows about this data or need to know about this data. And for example, then you can store this device is located in building 43 or 42 or in other use cases. This is a production device and this is a test device, so you can here have some additional properties in the cloud on stored on the IoT hub. Desired properties are properties that you're able to write in the cloud and can be read from the device. So basically, you write in the cloud, hey device, I would like to take this state. Then you write this in the desired properties. However, it does not mean that the device immediately take the state because this may be off or malfunctioning. So on the end, you cannot be sure. And so desired properties, reporting properties, and tags is eventually not consistent. The reporting properties are only writable from the device and readable in the cloud. So this is, The next management privilege is query, so you can have queries that say, hey, give me all my devices who are in building 43, or you write and say, give me all my devices that reports their own firmware is version 1, however, I desire that they have to have version 2, so this is you can do with query. The third device management property is methods. A method is an immediate action that you want to have taken on the device. The difference between message and messages is that a message you fire and forget. You did not know a status. In a method, you immediately get a status. Is received action, is executed or not. And the last primitive is job. So a job is on the end a chain of methods. So you can decide, for example, for a firmware update, you say first method is download a new firmware, second method, install the new firmware. In a very simple way, most of the time it's a little bit more complicated. This is a project what we did in Switzerland with a manufacturer who produced coffee machines for the largest coffee shop chain of the world. This is one of the biggest customers, more than 22,000 coffee shops. And this manufacturing company produced in Switzerland 100% of the machine, 80% of the supplier also coming from Switzerland. And they decide to make an IoT project to having all this information, having some reporting, but also predictive maintenance cases and so on. On the end, we use a CPU and IMX6 dual core. We use 1 GB RAM. Then we use 1 GB flash, and we split it to 2 OS partitions for the firmware upgrade on the end. So we download a complete new image to the machine. After the reboot, we start on the new image. If this fails, it falls back to the old image. And we have a third partition where we store status, counters, and even keys. We use embedded Linux based on Yacto project. Yacto, if you look at this, you can decide that your own image distribution on the end, yes, on a very easy way. We develop everything in C++ and using Azure IoT SDK in C. The protocol we use is AMQP over WebSockets. WebSockets have additional, the value add that you not always have open and closed the connection. And in addition, most of the firewalls allowed outgoing from 443. So this is the using. And yes, we're doing TLS. How an architecture looks then in the real world? We have here our device. Then our IoT hub, the core. Then we load everything in Stream Analytics, where we decide where the data follows then. We have here, on the end, if you're looking to the details, we have, we have 3 different data stores. We have a cold pass, that's a Lambda architecture, a cold pass where you're using data lake. We're having a warm pass where we're using Cosmos DB. And we're having a hot pass. We're having here some queues and some jobs who react immediately if this is necessary. On the cold pass, once they are, every hour we start a data factory pipe and loading the reporting to the SQL Server. For reporting, we use SQL Server. Why? We're using star models. Star models need effect table with keys, and keys in Cosmos DB is a pity. But all the rest of the data we store in Cosmos DB, why in Cosmos DB? Cosmos DB is globally distributed. You can easily scale it up and scale it down over geo, and you can write and read geo-redundant. On the end, if you're having a IoT hub and your stream analytics in Australia, you write on the end in the same Cosmos DB if you write it in Europe. On the end, the data synchronization is inside Asia on the Cosmos DB. So, and then we have some API backend to have getting the access to the data more simpler, having a web portal, Azure Active Directory for authentication the clients. Small sidestep, if you're using Azure Active Directory for your application, only one user is the administrator, everything else in the application is a connection between Asia to Asia, Active Directory, or you get business to customer with Google or Facebook accounts. Or you implement your own. And here you see also the chain of how we do the remote updates, because remote updates are very important. As soon your devices are in the cloud, you have to close security leaks and you have to take care about the devices can be updated. Now coming to IoT Edge. So there could be either the client, you are not able to install SDK on the client, or different other things. For example, one of the use cases for IoT Edge is to have real-time reaction on the of the insights. So, and when you have this problem, so if maybe you have a very old block, old device, what even was invented way before the internet, so this maybe speak not the right protocols. So then you, this is the right way for IoT Edge, and usually people deploy in this case a media device called a gateway. And this gateway, we use the IoT Edge runtime. What you can download on the end on the GitHub, and this is open source again. And this gateway is on the end, the heart and the soul of the runtime is to build around modules. And modules on the end are containers. So on the end, we're using here standard container technology, what you using state of the art. And we developed this with modules. And in this case, for example, if you're having already the case that you have not the right protocol, you use a device communication model, getting the data from the device. And the device communication model would then send to the IoT Edge runtime, and the IoT runtime bring it to the cloud. What we also implement here is, in the case you lose the connection, the runtime will automatically persist the data on the device until the time when the data, the connection comes back, and then deliver the data to the cloud. But as I already tell you, maybe you will not send old data to the cloud, and in this case you have to take filters, so you install another module using a filter, then you redesign the way that you send the device from the device communication to the filter, and the filter can send it to the cloud. Then when you have your data, you can do your data model, so you can do your data science models. When you have a scoring model, same as before, you can send it down to the edge. This is more or less the way we do it. And now we show this again as we do it with Schneider. Schneider has a Modbus, so we install a Modbus module. Then there was the necessity that we, in addition, doing some data conversation to understand it better. And on the end, we install the model, what we designed before in Asia, and load it down to the device. And now, if there is some issue, the edge device reacts immediately, send the information also to the IoT hub, and they send out the technician who can then have a local detail analyze the data, because there's also a local dashboard for all the data what we not send in the cloud, they can then analyze locally. Yes, what's the benefit? You have the high value add from IoT on the edge device. We can respond in real time. We have a second nice project. We have not it on the slide. In Switzerland, we spüle where we sort corns. There are some corns, and these corns are contaminated, only 5%, but these are dangerous regarding cancer. So on the end, they like to sort out these corns, and we're doing the data, the modeling we do in Asia to identify the corns, and then we load it down to the machine, and based on the small and the very quick reaction was necessary, we identified with video cameras and with ultraviolet light, we identified which corns have this contamination, and we sort them out. Another use case. So you really speak about if you need real time on the device. Yes, this makes the solution resilient regarding to the internet connectivity. Sometimes this could really be a pity, and we reduce the solution cost. Now a little bit about the hardware. On the end, we're supporting Linux and Windows on X64 and an ARM 32-bit processors. The only main requirement, because this is on GitHub, you can even download it and compile it by your own, is that the support of containers is required. Otherwise, it will not work. The hardware size depends on your requirements. On the end, we and also I are doing some tests on Raspberry Pi, and on the Raspberry Pi, we support up to 4 containers. So, and you buy a small Raspberry Pi, making and you can launch your own IoT Edge device. What we're doing regarding packages on containers, we have Stream Analytics. With Stream Analytics, we update our UI. So you can do the Stream Analytics, write your Stream Analytics jobs in the cloud. Then you upload, then more or less you package it and load it down to the device. Then we use support Azure Functions. Azure Functions, we have integration to Visual Studio Code so that you can create an Azure function Visual Studio Code, package it and upload it in a module, build a container, and then you load the container to your favorite container runtime. And from then, you have to go to the UI, or you can do it also with CLI on the in Azure, and then you can download it to your device. And many others in the queue. We have AI machine learning models where you can directly download it from the Machine Learning Studio. Many others also. On the end, this is only requires a container. And for example, you can also install a SQL Server, MySQL, or a Postgres SQL database on the device as long as it's a container. Yes, next step, if you'll be more interesting, you can learn more about on AKMS, Azure IoT Edge, or you can, there's a very extended documentation on Microsoft Docs, where you can have also some example codes and step-by-step examples how you work with this technology. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gerhard, thank you. All right, so we have time for one question, and we have one question. okay, so we'll go with that one question. I'm not sure if this is something that we can answer on the stage, but it is, how long does Microsoft guarantee that these Azure services will not get discontinued when using IoT Hub? Will it be for sure not get discarded or become obsolete in a number of years? Was the question.
Sorry. because I not hear it very well.
Yeah. Okay, so the question was, how long does Microsoft basically guarantee that Azure services will stay there forever and ever and not get discontinued?
I'm thinking, I'm the technician, yes? So exactly. Here, maybe you asked the wrong person, yeah. Yes? Yeah. Yeah. But you never know when a company says, based that this is not reliable, we stop the service. I have really explicit, because we're talking about the VR Developers Conference, skip all the marketing slides. Mm-hmm. Yes, so really try to make it as technical as possible. The footprint what we have right now is huge in the IoT mm-hmm. space. Yes, as alone in Switzerland, I have right now 8 projects running new. Okay, so as you can, in the IoT area, I think we are, the others in other areas better. AWS with infrastructure, but in PaaS service, especially in this area, or maybe in infrastructure, but in PaaS service in this area, we are very, very good. There's no comparable service. There's right now, I read in some news about Amazon that they consider now some better version with what is compared to Stream Analytics, and our Stream Analytics service is now quite old mm-hmm. and KR. And also this IoT Edge version, we're already working on the next version, so and I think 5 million we spend the next 3 years, $5 billion we spend the next years in the IoT technology. Mm-hmm. So amazing. The investments there is huge. The customer brand is also huge. The nice thing is I compare this always with playing Duplo. Mm-hmm. On the end, the investments to making a project is very easy. It's very easy. So if I heard about project where other customer says, no, we want to be independent and we do it on infrastructure in the cloud and then we're doing Hive MQ and all of these things. The more cost what you have Instead, you start small, because on the end, if you're looking at the project that I support, we are not talking about the huge investment on project size and also on the OPEX costs, because on the end, you begin small. And if then the business is really going and you grow up to millions of devices and you grow up with millions of devices, okay, maybe then you have to rethink about, and on the end, you learn a lot. But from my project experience, I would never start to build this by my own, because on the end, this is like Duplo, playing up, making up the services, connected, and this works.
For sure. Yeah, and I think we can definitely see also in this Congress that it is a very huge strategic importance of Microsoft. So thank you very much, Reinhard. Okay. And if you have any more questions, please find him near the stage. And we will regroup again at 6:15. Thank you, and please give a big round of applause.